It's fun. Okay, and we're live. Hello, hello, and welcome to the Literary Roadhouse Book Club. Today we're discussing Swing Time by Zadie Smith. I'm Anise, and I'm joined today by Literary Roadhouse regulars Tamara Woods and Gerald Hornsby. Hey, guys.
Hello. Hello.
I'm pretty excited to discuss this one. I think there's a lot of meat in it. So let's start as we always do, which is just what was your overall impression? We can start with Tamara.
I'm not sure yet.
I'm noticing a trend.
You know, I like there's aspects of the novel I really enjoyed, but there's other things I really didn't. And I wasn't totally sold on the narrator. And for me, if I'm not really sold on the narrator, I don't really feel like I like the book as much. But every time we have one of these discussions, my feelings end up changing by the end. Yeah. So, so I guess I'm just seeing what happens.
Yeah. Okay. So Gerald?
Yeah. I feel pretty much the same. It was a much longer book than I'm used to reading. And I think it was a bit saggy in places. I think there was too much detail and too much story almost that didn't really affect the main thrust of the story. And I said to Anais earlier that there were times when I wanted to sort of speed read and get ahead, but I couldn't because I was enjoying the writing so much. So I loved the way she tells the story. I just think it was overlong. That's my own personal feeling.
I can't frozen. Say. Oh, I'm still frozen.
Oh, you're back. Yeah, you're back.
So I can't say, oh, I liked it because I more than liked it. But I also can't say, oh, I loved it because then it's like it's that feeling of like, oh, it was a page turner, which it wasn't necessarily a page turner. So I think what I would say is I really enjoyed it because it's so smart, but it's not the kind of book where you just sit there and devour and you're like, oh, this is the greatest thing ever. Like, it doesn't have that like crack kind of feeling that you get sometimes as a reader where you can't put the book down. It's easy to put down, but you still enjoy reading it when you read it because I thought it was so smart. And part of what I thought was so smart was the way she drew the characters. So I wanted to start with the narrator because Tamara said she wasn't sold on the narrator. What do you mean by that?
I guess as I was reading from the narrator, she is never named. She who has no name. Really her not having a name was kind of telling in her personality. She kind of saw herself in the lens of who she was with and how they interacted with her. And I don't know, I guess I couldn't connect with that. I had a hard time connecting with her, mm-hmm. with her voice.
Mm-hmm. Gerald, did you have that experience?
I didn't because I think I tend to give narrators a sort of free pass. In a way, I don't expect anything of them because when there's a narrator, I expect the story to be in the other characters rather than her or the main character, and I feel that the main character is a foil for the story and the characters that are happening around them. So I didn't, and I suppose now she was a pretty sort of fleshed out character. She was, which is sort of unusual that you learn a lot about her as well as the other characters in the story. I was quite happy with the narrator.
Yeah, it's interesting to hear Tamara say that the narrator would sort of be defined by the person which she was with, which I thought was very true and very skillfully done. Like, I think that's definitely true. in my reading of it, but also, like Gerald said, she's still very fleshed out. Like, she is, she lives in her mind. She's pretty selfish and self-absorbed, not in a materialistic way. She's necessarily greedy, but just in a, she, it's like she craves a lot of like attention and validation and everything like that. She needs to feel like she's the most important one to all the various people that she meets, right? Like, she constantly needs to be the most important one, the most important thing in their lives too. So yeah, she felt very real to me. And, but I will say, I don't have super strong opinions about her as a person in the way I seem to have with everyone else, right?
No.
Which might be a little bit of the foil thing that Gerald was talking about. Like, there was times where I wanted to shake the narrator a bit, but I was never like super, you know, one way or the other about her.
Maybe that ambivalence is what I don't like.
Mm-hmm.
That I didn't feel strongly one way or another, and I feel like I should have, because I was living her life for 400 pages.
Yeah,
I should have felt closer to her, but I did not.
And I wonder if maybe the reason why you don't feel closer to her was something that I kept coming back to as I read the story, which is, what is her aim? The fact that she is so aimless. Like, she never really has a clear goal. I can't root for her. What am I rooting for? You know, like, that was something that there was various points that I'm like taking notes for the podcast where I'm like, what's her goal? What is she doing?
Yeah. And she starts off as wanting to be a dancer, and it becomes, when she starts to associate with Tracy, it becomes clear to her that she's not to the standard of dance as Tracy is, but she seems to develop a sort of a thing for singing, and but that just sort of, apart from the once where she was in a club and Amy gets you know, hacked off with her for staying behind and singing and being almost the star of the show in the bar, it sort of never reappears. So yeah, it's that was something, but then it was just sort of dropped, and yeah, she just seems to sort of drift along with the story and never really sort of pushes things, never really instigates parts of the story. It's all about things that happen around her and how she reacts to them.
Yeah.
She's definitely reactionary. And then, like, when she ends up a goth, remember that, when she's gothic? And that was just more of her being like, okay, I'm looking around. I don't have Tracy anymore. Who can I hang out with? Well, the goth take me. They'll take anybody. Yeah. Here I go. And that just felt like a kind of a continuing theme, that she just fell into whatever happened.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She didn't have a lot of self-direction.
Mm-hmm.
And the one time she has self-direction is so ill-advised, the whole Sankofa adoption thing. Like, the one time where she's like, I'm going to act on my own and start shit. It's like, this was not. This was not the good move. So let's talk about the other characters, which all were very goal-oriented, I felt. Especially who was the two most goal-oriented, in my opinion, and the two other biggest characters are probably her mother and Tracy. Yeah. Who should we start with? Do you guys feel strongly or more strongly about either one?
Mother.
Mother? Yeah. Okay. So, Gerald, why do you want to start with the mother?
Because because we join the story when she's an adult, I think it's interesting, because it's easy to write to tell a story from about a child as they're growing up and developing and encompassing new ideas and changing rapidly. So I think it's a lot easier to show a story about a child and a youth and a teenager. But an adult, when they've had a child and when they're in a stable, semi-stable relationship, I think it's fascinating the way she made this such a standout interesting character who was there's just so much about her life and that you know, she didn't care for cooking or tidying the house or something. She was always reading. She did the Open University degree. I just loved the way that she's such a big, such a strong character, and she has goals. Does she have goals?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Tamara.
Yeah, her daughter is like her antithesis in that way. Yeah. She is so incredibly goal oriented and so very much a strong personality, and her daughter's kind of like paint drying in comparison to her mom.
How do you really feel though?
I mean, I'm just saying. I was like, girl, could you please just get your life? She just didn't. Okay. Anyway, but her mother was very dynamic. She was very much a revolutionary. It was interesting to see her transitioning through her relationships and growing older. And, you know, when you're more youthful, you have like more vigor and you're more of a revolutionary. But as she was growing older, she still maintained it to a certain extent, but I think it kind of smoothed out a little bit as she became sicker. And she was definitely an interesting character. Yeah. I hadn't expected her. So that was cool.
And I think it was only her illness that really slowed her down, wasn't it? Until then, she was bang, 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 doing this, doing that, and you know, became a member of parliament and all these different things, and continually not just settling on member of parliament, but you know, new initiatives and trying to help people, and it was just the illness that where she just suddenly couldn't do that anymore.
Yeah, I think she was probably my favorite character. I really like the mother. She was just like a force, like just her will. I mean, so one of the things I found really interesting about the mother is, you know, throughout the book, the narrator criticizes her sometimes for being a bit removed, a bit cold, not very nurturing, which is true, but she's also not cruel. She's definitely not neglectful. She is picking that girl up when she is a teenager at 12:30 on the dot at the club. She is dragging her where she needs to go. So it's like her will. She's also trying to will her daughter into, you know, becoming more than what most people at the estate are going to grow up to become. And for American listeners, estate in this case is not a rich manor. The Britishism for basically the projects.
Yeah.
You know, the narrator could have very easily ended up in a similar boat to Tracy. It's really her mother who got her far enough from all of that to, I don't want to say make something of herself, because I don't know if being the person who's a celebrity is making something of yourself, but it's definitely better than the fate that a lot of other kids that she grew up with would likely encounter. So I feel like sometimes the bit of criticism against the mother for not necessarily being warm and lovey and cuddly, I'm like, yeah, no one's perfect, but she did everything she could for her community and for the advancement of her child as well. And I had a lot of respect for that. Like, I feel like the narrator picked the wrong role model. Should have been your mom, not Amy. Yeah. I really like that character. Even if she was, you know, kind of ridiculous sometimes, right? Like, you can't have a conversation with her. Like, oh, I saw Louis, Tracy's father, in, you know, Kent ship, was it, or Kenton? And the mom's like, well, here's what you don't understand. She goes back to like the 1600s, right? Like, she's a bit ridiculous. She's like a cartoon, but it's because she's just so passionate. I really liked her. I liked her a lot.
And she's a real feminist without being a strident feminist, without pushing a feminist agenda all the time. But it's just natural to her. She's just strong, strong woman.
I also found that sometimes an editor would be like, even though she was a feminist, she cared about this thing. And I'm like, back off. All right. You're a little vanity. Like, stop. Like, she was so critical of her mother sometimes where I was just like, really? Just because she's a feminist, you're like, oh, she's watching her weight. We're all allowed vanity, feminist or not. Like, who cares? I was very defensive of the mother, probably because with the mother, there was some of her mother's flaws where I was like, I have that exact same flaw, and Zadie Smith is helping me become a better person.
Hooray!
Yeah, there was a few. Yeah, there was a few points where there were some real flaws about the mother, and I'm like, that's me.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like one that really stood out for me was when she's foreshadowing to the divorce between her parents, and she's talking about how the mother, when she grew bored with the father, she projected and assumed that the father had grown bored with her. That projection of other people when you want a distance, I do that. It's not good. That's how I broke up with my college boyfriend of many years. Exactly like that. And I'm like, yeah, I should work on that. Thank you, Zadie Smith. Yeah. So, any more thoughts on the mother? Should we move on to Tracy?
Yeah, move on.
Let's move on.
So maybe somebody who should be no one's role model. I shouldn't say that. That's harsh. But yeah, at the other end of the spectrum, we have Tracy.
Yeah. I love Zadie Smith's characterization is so strong, so good. Strong. And to get these female characters that are so different without being caricatures, they're real characters. You can see them and you can hear them. And Tracy, yeah, you know, the way she acts when she's a young girl, you know, I don't know, but apparently that's how young girls act. You know, they're best friends one minute, total animosity the next.
That is true to life.
I just loved it. She's a sort of victim of a circumstances, isn't she, Tracy? Yeah. Really, I think
she's pretty tragic.
Yeah.
She didn't have anyone in her corner like the narrator did. Like, her mom wanted a lot for her, but her mom didn't have that direction and focus and drive to push her in a positive direction.
Yeah, or just maybe life wisdom, because her mother did bring her to every single practice. Her mother did make sure she, you know, like, her mom took her where she needed to be, but didn't give her the necessary advice. Like again, a circumstances thing. She just didn't have a mother as wise as the narrators.
Her mom's relationship with her felt more like a friendship rather than a mother-daughter relationship. Like, remember that scene where her mom says something incredibly rude to the narrator and she was taken aback? Like, I can't believe a mom said that to me. So, yeah.
And I think it's also because, again, Zadie Smith with the perfect characterizations, is that the mother was very much living vicariously through her daughter. It was an extension of herself, of her being. So it was like the things that she... It was like with Tracy, it was more about Tracy needs to get all the praise. Tracy needs to be the best. She is the best. There was no sort of criticism really of Tracy ever. It was just sort of this warped kind of like symbiosis between them that wasn't helpful. You know, like, the mother loved Tracy and would take Tracy where Tracy needed to go. But there was this sort of like egotism to it that was unhelpful.
Yeah, I think I've seen and experienced people like Tracy's mother, who don't consider it their job to educate their child at home. So educate in the wider sense of you know, learning about the world. So yes, she took her to you know, she physically took her to places and collected her and all this sort of stuff, but she didn't give her any wisdom. And you know, that's somebody else's job to do that. And I, that really rang true for me. I've seen people like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And going back to sort of the tragic part of Tracy as well, is again, the narrator's mother, my idol now, you know, at the end, she has a lot of regret about not having done more for Tracy. Who the narrator, I don't think, is wrong when she remembers from her childhood that her mother didn't really like Tracy, probably because she was being really protective. She saw Tracy as a bad influence on her kid. And then in retrospect, is like, I should have done more to help this person who was raised pretty much like a sister to my daughter. And I think there's a lot of truth in that too, because there's all these hints of abuse. Is it, you know, physical, sexual, emotional at home? It's never really pinned down what exactly happened to Tracy, but you know, it's something happened and you know, it was bad and that it broke her. There was that passage about, oh my God, about, this is when they're in Gambia, about the girls. There's always that the girl who has the secret she can't tell. Doesn't matter where you are, whether it's in London or in Gambia, a classroom, everyone affects everyone. That moved me. It's because it's so true. And in the story, we have confirmed Amy, who's a celebrity, who's super rich, and Tracy, who grew up in this estate. And it's just like pervasive throughout all the aspects of society, across continents, without ever being exploitative. Zadie Smith never describes any of it in detail, which I think works in service of the message she's trying to make. Like, she's not exploiting it to be like, oh, and look how gross this is, or look how squeamish this is, or look how horrible this is, to get a rise out of the reader. It's just, here are the facts, and then you're just moved by the facts. You're not like getting some weird perverse thrill from seeing it depicted.
Yeah. And I think Zadie Smith is so good at building well-rounded characters that yes, they have their positive points, they have negative points, and everything in between. And I love that about Tracy, that sometimes she, you know, she's, when she's growing up, you see her as just a little girl who wants to do well and wants to be the best. And yes, she can be mean sometimes, but other times she's, you know, she's quite caring and quite thoughtful too.
Mm-hmm. And her father, her relationship with her father was very interesting. As at first, it's all about her fantasies of her father. Her father is a backup dancer for Michael Jackson, and her father is amazing, and this is where she gets her dancing from. And then as time goes on, as things do, the narrator realizes that her father actually is in and out of jail and is living a town over and just doesn't care about Tracy enough to be relevant in her life. And I think that I can hear. I think that that characterization of the father and Tracy really showed in her relationships with other men, and what we saw, how she reacted with them, and how she kind of took on these positions with the male characters as more of power instead of love or caring or even intimacy. At least what we saw. Because granted, there was big gaps in the relationship with her and the narrator, so there could have been, you know, a whole lot of loving going on that we didn't see, but just what we saw, it seemed like it was more about power than, like, personal feelings.
Yeah, because there was the affair she was having when she was on Guys and Dolls with one of the older performers who was married. She's having an affair with this guy, and it's described as really being a power game. Like, she just wants to make this guy feel small and beg for her, basically. And she's very mean. She's very, very mean, and she has no problem destroying someone's life on a whim, like she does to Mr. Booth.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Poor Mr. Booth.
Poor Mr. Booth. He just seemed like a nice guy who just wanted to help out.
Yeah.
And he helps her.
Yeah, he helps her a lot.
But it seems like she did that. The people who cared about her the most were the people who were going to get knocked down the most, I guess.
Yeah, she had no loyalty.
Yeah.
At all.
And I think isn't there a sort of psychological trait in people where the closer you get to someone, the more they want to hurt you, the more they rail against it and fight against it. And wasn't it when she saw how the narrator was singing with Mr. Booth and on the piano, and wasn't that the trigger for her you know, spreading that story about Booth and destroying him? And it seemed, you know, again, that's probably just a reaction for her wanting to be the best, wanting to be the main person, the main character, and can't stand anyone else being, you know, getting the limelight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And so moving on a bit to the other characters, I felt like those three were like three really main characters, even though we do see a lot of Amy. But I don't know. Do you guys have strong opinions about Amy?
Amy just, her character seemed to me like the typical rich person who was kind of out of touch, but felt like she was really in touch and knew the people, and she's really down with the people, but she had no idea what was happening with the people.
I saw her as Madonna.
Mm-hmm. Yes! Yes!
Madonna,
yes.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. I don't think that was an accident.
And yet sometimes Amy did good things and did nice things and seemed to be a good character and have positive things to say and do. And yet other times she was just an asshole. So it's just very strange.
Yeah, she was just a narcissist. And narcissists are capable of doing good things sometimes when it makes them feel good, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And the thing with Amy is I feel like Amy was probably a foil as well. Why did it take the narrator so long to, you know, because she idolized Amy and was also jealous of her. There's a lot of jealousy throughout this book as well. Sometimes I felt the narrator was even jealous of her mother in the very beginning when she's like, oh, she didn't wear makeup, but you don't have to when you look like Nefertiti. I'm like, okay. You know. But, you know, yeah, it's funny. With Amy, like, she was just such, like, a celebrity, narcissist, pop star type. Like, she names the school basically after one of her albums, the school in Gambia. Yeah.
Yeah. So much, so cringeworthy.
Yeah. So, you know, there's just, like, a... It's almost like I don't care what happens to Amy because she's always going to be fine. Like the whole Sankofa thing, releasing the information about the adoption papers, my reaction was, oh, you shouldn't have done that. Not because I felt bad for Amy. She'll be fine. Just because it was like a narrator, you're like shooting yourself in the foot, you know?
Yeah, because you know Amy has the connections and has the money to spin the narrative any way she wants. So whatever you do to her, there'll be a positive spin to it, and you know you can't touch her. She's Teflon.
Yeah.
And the narrator knew how all that worked. She was like deeply entrenched in it until she kind of wasn't. Mm-hmm. So she knew how Amy has this whole team of people whose job is basically just to take care of her every whim.
Yeah. Wow. And her only real friend, mate, probably is Judy.
Yeah, I think so. She's been there the longest.
And I feel like Judy, she had her there really was like an example of her being down with the people. Judy's from my hometown, you know?
Mm-hmm. And, but also, Judy's a pit bull. Who wouldn't want to have Judy in your corner? She will kill anyone for you.
Yeah.
I'd want a Judy. Just like attacks people for me.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
For ride or die.
Yeah. So there's almost like two worlds of characters. So now we're starting to get into like the smaller characters-ish. It's kind of weird to think of the narrator's father as a smaller character, but he didn't have a huge impact on the story. I feel like she inherited her lack of ambition from her father.
Definitely. Definitely.
Yeah. Yeah, good point.
He just wanted to have a family, mm-hmm. and work his job, hang out, smoke mm-hmm. a spliff every now and then with his brother-in-law, and just live life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there's like the London cast of minor characters, ranging from her father to like Bahram, the Iranian pizza owner, who was hilarious.
Oh my gosh.
I love that bit.
Like, see, that's the thing. Gerald at the top of this said, there's a lot of stuff that has nothing to do with the main story, but it's still a joy to read. The whole Bahram, Anwar, Shelton game thing is like a perfect example of that. You could cut that out of this book. Nothing changes in the book. Nothing. But it was hilarious. It was still a joy to read.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that description, joy to read, because it was. And that provided a little bit of light, because she did almost have cliche characters there, and the just the description of the place and how it ran was fantastic. It was just like almost like a comedy sketch dropped into it, but she was there and it was part of her life and I think it was. It didn't feel out of place, strangely, even though it contributed nothing, but it was just think, oh yeah, here's an episode, and it was, you know, self-contained and beautifully written and very funny, and yeah, and we moved on from that. It's very, very good. That.
Tamara, did you not think it's funny? I'm trying to read your face, but I can't tell if it's...
He was a character that irritated the hell out of me.
I mean, he's super racist. He's super racist.
Like, he pissed me off so much. I was just like, I like that everyone kind of rallied around the television to watch this tennis match. You know, yeah. That was cool. And how they like danced
yeah.
stuff with like Sheldon won.
Sheldon, yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. I didn't really enjoy it as much, but I thought that it was interesting because the way that race was treated in this novel was a very interesting, I don't know, it was really interesting to me. So initially, I wasn't sure of the narrator's race. I couldn't narrow it down. I was like, okay, I see that her mom is very much about kind of a Black Power type of movement.
She's Jamaican, though. The mom's Jamaican.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But she was very all about Black Power. Mm-hmm. But I couldn't tell what her father was. And then as we moved on, I realized, oh, okay, dad's white. It's interesting. And then, like, the way her race was perceived by other people. So the guy at the pizza shop, he's like, oh, well, the tennis guy, he's like you. He's brown. So, you know, he's half and half, so it's fine. And then when she's in Africa and she's not really seen as being Black there, they equate her more to being like Amy than they equate her to being like themselves. And it felt like part of her ambiguity as a character, it seemed to be related to how she felt about her race and how she perceived herself. She didn't really know where she fit in any aspect of life, whether it was with the people who were around her or with just her race. She just didn't know how to navigate things. And I think that her mom being so incredibly militant didn't help her to figure out who she was and how she could balance these two aspects of herself. And her father having the exact opposite of direction, I think, added to that. Because he didn't really assert himself as having like a strong background or talking about who he was and really like, who was he? What was his background? What did he care about? he didn't really talk to her about that. He didn't teach her about that side of her family, really.
Yeah, well, there was the one scene where, so the father comes from a long line of basically poor white English folk, because there's the one line where she's looking at her father shows her his birth certificate, and it has the grandparents rags cutter and rags steamer, like they're like factory workers. And he had a stint in jail, I think, or his father did. His father, definitely, her grandfather, father's father, had some stint in jails. And then this guy had a whole family before, had two kids with a family before, and seemed to, you know, he was trying to, I guess, correct for the way that he was brought up and was into the whole family thing. But he was a very simple guy. He just wanted to live and let live. Like...
See, he was a simple guy, but then, like you just mentioned, the two kids pop up out of nowhere. Mm-hmm. So it's like he was simple, but there was a complexity that it's like he just didn't engage in it.
Yeah. Yeah, he did. He didn't have an interest really in explaining himself, because I think he isn't a person who thinks of himself as something that needs to be explained. Like, he's that simple. You know what I mean? Like, the only time he was really reading was to impress her mother.
Yeah.
Poor guy.
I think there's people like that. There's a lot of people like that who there's just, which is fine. You know, they're just like, look, I have my job. I've got my friend who comes over once a week and we smoke weed and whatever. That's it. They just.
I think it's quite interesting how she dealt with the race thing, because I was just looking now and couldn't find it, but there's this one particular part where she enunciates that thing that she's, to some people she's white and to some people she's black and to some people she's brown. So she doesn't know where she fits in, I think. And she has this sort of vague identity, racial identity that perhaps she's not comfortable with, and she can't she can't associate and feel associated with certain races because she is not one thing or the other.
Mm-hmm. Remember when, what musical was it? She was, it might have actually been in the prologue where she was showing the person a musical and it was one of her favorites. And then she realized that the main character was in blackface.
Yeah, Alibaba Goes to Town. That one.
And she was, I think so. And she was incredibly embarrassed, and she realized that she hadn't internalized the blackface. And I felt like that was just a strong indication of how she kind of perceived race. That, mm-hmm. And then remember, there was that one side character, the girl, I think her name was Lily.
Lily Bingham, who doesn't see color. Yeah.
Oh, my God. I was like, oh, so that's how they start. Oh, the people who don't see color. And then she was saying that, so the narrator had shown her, she was showing her another musical, narrator loved musicals. And this Lily girl, who was always so sweet and wonderful, and so nice to everybody and still played with dollies. And she started going off about how we don't like it when it's a movie that's all about black people. and the narrator's like, who does she mean by we? Mm-hmm. She was incredibly thrown off by that. And yeah, so race was interesting.
Yeah, and Lily was 9 or 10. She was like 9 or 10 at that point. Yeah. Yeah, she was upset because the movie had all black characters, and she was like, oh, why does it have to be all black? Like, it's fine to have representation, but then you overdo it when they're all black. It's just like, a 10-year-old.
Wow.
Yeah. So you described the mother, you said, you know, militant, and I wanted to come back to that word because what was interesting to me is it was like, she was like a word general, but the reason I'm saying this is because, you know, when she was dating the guy, the noted activist, she was like, oh, the noted activist, he knew Malcolm X, right? She had all these aspirations and she admired actually militant revolutionaries. But there was that whole long passage that I thought was beautiful about how the mother herself wouldn't know what to do once the revolution actually came. Because when Louis is so mad, because remember, so Louis Tracy's father, they have the rundown like bike repair shop that his gang like uses for like their criminal plannings. And all of a sudden the mother, who's a local counselor, takes it over to use it as a community space. Louis and his gang burn it down, make it personal, and make sure that she knows. And she has no real response to that. She has no reaction to that, except, well, what you need to understand is Louis, his history, the family, you know, the ancestry, blah, blah, blah. All she has is words all the time, but she never actually has like the violence or the fight in her, which I thought was interesting as well. Like she can only get as far as policy can get her.
She's a politician.
Yeah, she's a politician, 100%. Yeah. But like, yeah, the whole, she wouldn't know what to do when the revolution came. Which is fine, she doesn't have to, but. Yeah.
She can leave the fighting to everybody else, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it's just the way that Zadie Smith characterizes all these people. They feel so real. And then the mom does that same thing too. We're like, the way, this is another thing that I've caught myself doing. Thank you, Zadie Smith, for helping me introspect, which is, when you're mad at someone or you're done with someone or you're just like venting, so you do the whole, here's a nice thing about them, but also here's a kind of negative thing. With the whole Miriam thing, where she was like, Miriam was really very sweet and had great ideas, but she was like an effective administrator. Harsh, you know? And then the narrator had that thought of like, will my epitaph for my mother be like, met well, competent, like dinner date or whatever? Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
There were some light and quite funny moments in the book for considering what the book was about. I quite liked that. I quite liked, because sometimes when you're dealing with somebody's life, when you're reading about somebody's life, you can get so bogged down with what's happening around them and with them. It's lovely to have these sort of lighter moments and these little things where you can just sit and smile and think, that was good. Yes, I enjoyed that.
So we've been talking for almost 44 minutes now and haven't moved on from characters, which was something I was worried about because this book is so rich with characters. We haven't even touched on like Hawa and everything that was happening in Gambia and Fernando. Like, there's just so much. It's so character-rich. But I kind of want to jump away from characters. Just talk about, like, plot, story. What happened, and what does it mean? Whoever wants to take that away.
Steps back.
Everyone just sits back. Because... I feel like not that much actually happened. Nothing you couldn't guess from the first 20%. She's gonna sleep with this guy that you'd be like very early on. I felt like it was so heavily signaled. By the time it happened, the only surprise was that Fernando did it. It was the one who leaked it. But maybe there's more plot than I'm seeing. Gerald's nodding. Maybe.
I'm nodding in that I understand what you're saying, but I can't. It's basically the story of somebody's life, isn't it? And the characters that surround her. So is there a character arc? I don't know if there is. It's like a character line. It's you know, good stuff happens, bad stuff happens, and it sort of continues that way all the way through. And so you go through the period of when she's the assistant or whatever she is to Amy, which is the main part of the book, and you still have the familial characters interacting and Tracy interacting. I suppose not a lot really happens, does it? It's just what happens to her. Enlighten me.
Yeah. Tamara, do you have anything to add?
Let's see. I think that, I don't know, maybe that's one of my problems with it, that there wasn't so much things that happened to her or that she made happen. It was the things that happened around her and everybody else's lives. She was like an observer in her own life. And, but I thought it was really interesting how it was all laid out, because we learn about her childhood and we learn about her present basically at the same time. And I didn't feel confused, even if I would jump from the past to the present, from one chapter to the next, I didn't feel confused by it. It was written so well. And I was reading that because I kind of want to do that with what I'm writing right now. And it's just like, oh.
I kept doing that too, yeah.
Like, yeah. Could you just please teach me your ways?
I had so many teach me your way moments.
Like, she was so, it was written so well. And I think that's what, like, that's why I'm torn. Because on the one hand, it's really well crafted. And the characters are really well done. But the narrator drives me nuts. I just want to shake her. Like, just live.
I think when you're writing stories and you're reading advice on writing stories and they say, take your protagonist, give them a goal, and then give them an antagonist to stop them reaching that goal. And you think, that's the basic story structure, but you don't have that here. You don't have, as we've said before, she doesn't have a goal. She just sort of goes through life very much like a father, just sort of does this, does that. But having said that, that sounds like a criticism, and it isn't a criticism because her life, the way it's written, is so rich because the characters are so beautiful. And I think the interaction between her and the characters always stays true. So whatever the character is and whatever their life is, her interaction with that character stays true. So I think that's so well done by the author that you sort of kind of forgive the fact that there's no traditional story arc to this.
So I think I'm like, it's like I half agree and then half don't agree. So the part that I half agree with is, yeah, there's no clear character goal here, but I do think there's still a character arc, and it just happens to her, which is, I think the very last line in the book is she's walking down the bridge, and instead of worrying about the boys who fell overboard, no, there was like a fight and then some kid drowned and they were like criminals, like there was this whole thing, and then her mom had lectured her about like the circumstances and, you know, the African diaspora and everything like that that was tied to the story about these kids who fell off the bridge. She walks down the bridge, she doesn't think about the story, and she's just walking down the middle, and considering that the story visits so many times, like, what are your roots, who's your tribe, what defines you when you have biracial identity, it's pulling you in two directions. How do you walk that line? So the fact that she's ending by walking down, very specifically, it's written, walking down the center of the bridge, I think is supposed to signal to us that she's done being pulled in all these different directions by these people. She's shed Amy, and in the epilogue, she sheds Tracy. She very briefly thinks, oh, I can be an aunt to Tracy's kids and we can be friends again. And I need her approval again. She's like, no. And then she lets that go and she lets Amy go. So I think even though she had no goal, somehow at the end of it, she still emerged from this much more mature than she was throughout the bulk of the book. The thing is, this isn't tested. We don't see her as a much more mature person. But towards the end of the book is when she does her like one thing, which is the Sankofa thing, which is ill-advised. But that's why those guys, Daryl and James, are like, oh, you're still so young, right? Because there's a way in which this woman in her early 30s is still very immature, doesn't know who she is. It's like the longest coming of age story. Starts when she's 9 and ends when she's 32 or 33. Long coming of age.
That's, yeah, That's the summary right there. It's a longest coming of age story.
Yeah. Takes a long time.
Very good. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, I feel like there is a character arc, but I agree that there's no clear goal. You know, she's not. Yeah. Because, like, even the way that she, like, approaches her relationships, it just happened to her. Like, Lamin, it was just, oh, he called Amy old. We're totally going to do it. Yeah. Okay.
She lost her virginity at that club.
Yeah.
She's a goth girl, and she's just in the balcony looking down, and then some guy walks in, and they look at each other like, okay, we're going to do this. And, like, yeah. And then afterwards, he's like, I didn't use any protection. She's like, oh, it's fine.
Yeah.
I was like, what?
She's what? So passive. Yeah, or her college relationship with Rakim. She's with a guy who, like, basically is constantly undermining her, making her feel small. And she's like, that's fine. Up until it isn't, I guess. But, yeah.
And then to realize that he, too, was mixed race, and his mom was like really into her mom. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh my gosh, he's so self-hating. That's what this is.
Oh yeah. Oh, again, I see we spent like 44 minutes straight just talking about characters, and I still just want to talk about characters because so many of my notes was just the names of people I know. Like, she would have a line and be like, oh, this is so-and-so. Oh, this is so-and-so. This is so-and-so. It felt so real. I got to the point where one time I actually copied that line to a person and said, isn't this you?
Oh, really?
To my friend. And my friend was like, it is me.
Wow.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah, Rakim. There was some aspects of Rakim that reminded me of my brother that I was just like, what? It was just, it was creepy, like uncanny. Yeah.
Yeah.
So let's go back to what the story is about. Like, we haven't gotten there.
Wow.
So it's about finding your identity, your roots, tribes. There's a lot of references like motherhood, having babies, the continuation, I guess, of tribes and of those roots.
Just froze.
But then people were like a shadow of themselves. She kept using the word shadow to describe people when they were doing an activity that wasn't true to themselves, that I thought was very smart and very sneaky. Zadie Smith. Like, there were times where my Kindle, I was telling Gerald, it crashed and I lost all my notes from 59% to 88%. Gerald doesn't believe Kindles can crash, but it can. I had highlighted a whole bunch of places where she would describe somebody who wasn't being true to themselves as doing something in the shadows or as a shadow person. So Hawa, when she completely changes her personality to marry the Taglibi guy, there's a whole gotten into. We don't have enough time for like the whole Gambia story. But like when Hawa changes her entire personality, she becomes a shadow person. Whenever the narrator does something that isn't true to herself at the behest of someone else, she's a shadow person. She's the most shadowy person who's described as doing as being a shadow figure. Mm-hmm. So I thought that was really interesting. But then why is it called Swing Time? Why is there so much dance? And why are there so many references to beats, rhythm, and time? How does that tie into everything else is beyond me.
Yeah, because it's a recurring theme, isn't it? The sort of the dancing and the musicals and that sort of thing. But it's not a strong theme to the story. It's not terribly important to the story. It's just something that comes in and again, and she goes to see Tracy and you know, Tracy's in a musical and then comes out again. I suppose it's because she sees Tracy dancing on the balcony with her children, and maybe that's the arc from kids looking, you know, starting dance school, and because that's really where the story starts, when they start dance school and she starts to form a relationship with Tracy, and it finishes with Tracy dancing on the balcony with her kids. But it's not, it's not an overriding theme to the story, is it?
But I feel like dance is a much stronger motif than you're suggesting, because Amy sees herself primarily as a dancer. In the Gambian village, the narrator is complimented for dancing well. She has this sort of like epiphany moment watching the Kakuranga dance happen that the Mandunka tribe does. There's a whole Gambian thing here.
Wow.
The cultural appropriation that she talks about has to do with Amy is stealing sort of dance moves from these tribes. Growing up, she wanted to be a dancer and was flat-footed. Her date with Kramer has to do with the dance in Showboat. Like, dance keeps coming up everywhere. Louis also is an amazing dancer. There's so many dancers, and there's so many descriptions of beats. And sometimes there's beats even when it isn't music, when it's just like a crowd. And she'll talk about like beats she recognizes and understands, beats she doesn't. But then I can't tie it into the rest of the story. Mm. Like it's there and it's pervasive, but it doesn't like tie in a way to this thing about like where you're from or what your identity is with the long coming of age story.
But
that's what I was trying to suggest without wording it as well as you did. But yeah, it kept coming up, but it wasn't, you know, what was the purpose of it? Unless it tied the two ends together and then peppered throughout without actually being meaningful.
In all cultures, there's music and there's dancing. Mm-hmm. And I think that for her, the being able to fall kind of in love with musicals and falling in love with dancing and singing and having an actual talent for singing, even though she doesn't actually pursue it in any way other than being someone else's personal assistant who is a singer and dancer. So she's kind of living again through her, kind of like the way Tracy's mother lived through Tracy. She was able to find kind of ways into groups through dancing and music. That was her connection with people. But it's interesting that in some ways that theme of dance and musicals doesn't feel as strong. The book's named after a musical, you know, but it doesn't feel as strong. But that is like the thing about her that's very prominent. But yet it still doesn't, we're still trying to parse out what exactly does it mean for her though? What does it mean that she loves these musicals and that she would be blind to race, right? She was colorblind when she was watching musicals. She didn't realize that there was all these racist overtones until she was older. Like, what does that mean for her? And remember Tracy, she used one of the dances that the narrator introduced her to in order to get into that dancing school.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was all interconnected in some way.
Yeah, she later changes her name to be similar. So the dancer that she sees is like Jenny Legong, and later she becomes Tracy LeRoy. She changes her name in a similar way too.
Yeah.
Tracy wasn't subtle.
No. Tracy was crazy, because let's not forget, she ended up believing in reptilians and the Illuminati and all that.
Oh man. I was like, oh no, not the reptilian thing. Don't do that. Don't go down that shadowy path.
And Rakim had like a slightly more intellectual approach to it. He called it the 10 percenters, but it was basically the same thing as like the Illuminati. He was the 5 percenter, considered himself a god.
Yeah, I was like, what?
I know. The thing is, he's not the first person I've... You see, I say person like he's real. These characters feel so real. I know people who have been like, basically that they're like, they believe they're gods. Like, for real.
Wow. Yeah. I have not had that experience and I'm cool with it. But then... In Africa, again, comes the Illuminati, remember?
Yeah.
So that's like another thing that it's kind of strange that followed her all over the world.
Also, I thought it was really funny when Hawa was like, you know, when the narrator's like, oh, the Illuminati is not real. And Hawa's like, oh, yeah, these kids these days believe everything on the internet. I think the Illuminati is real, but obese people, not true.
Not so much. I was like, oh, man.
Yeah. The characters, really. Just read the story for the characters.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just a joy to read. I really enjoyed reading it, but I can't tell you. I mean, the plot's just, you see it coming from a mile away. So.
It definitely wasn't about the plot.
No.
If you're a person who reads books and is about a plot-driven book, this probably isn't going to work for you as well. But if you love good characters, this is your spot.
Yeah.
Good characters and like really, really smart, honest looks at different types of people. Like I constantly read this book. I'm like, oh, this is this person all the time. I saw one of my brothers. I saw my best friend. I saw myself. I saw my dad. I saw so many people in this book. I'm just like, that's crazy. It's rare to have a book that does that.
It felt really realistic.
It's so sharp and focused. I just don't know on what, but it's sharp.
Oh my God, that's like the tagline.
Yeah. It's really interesting because it's a very British book and it's about British characters. So yeah, I can understand the scenes and the settings and the people and I said earlier, I've seen people like this, but it's quite interesting that has seamlessly translated over to the USA. That you can have that same relationship with the story and with the characters that I do.
Mm. Well, I mean, remember when the narrator's in Gambia and Hawa's brother Babu's like, oh, you from New York? And she just says yes, because it's easier than explaining. She's from London. She's like, sure.
Yeah.
I was like, why can't you say you're from London, though? Like,
but that's still true, too. Because, like, when I'm, like, here, there's a lot of the Gambian stuff that also, like, reminded me of just, like, living in Costa Rica, like, the expat thing. There's times also when it's just easier to, like, people assume that they're like, yeah, that's fine. Because I don't want to have the same conversation over and over. Of like, where I'm from, how I got here, why I got here, like, that's fine. Whatever.
Yeah. Whatever.
Yeah. Also, the thing where she's talking about how in Gambia, she just was able to just, like, share in the patience of everybody around her and just, like, not be impatient for once and just be fine with the fact that this fairy is going to be here for hours. Mm. And we just, you know, and that's something that I experienced for the first time, you know, in Costa Rica. And I was like, oh, that's so true. Like the first time you're just like, it doesn't matter if the bus is 3 hours late. It's fine. Everyone's fine.
Everything's fine.
Yeah. Okay. We're coming up on the hour and I had wanted to go more into the prose, but I feel like we're all just going to say, we kind of touched on it. We were like, it's really good. I can't even begin to analyze it because I lost so many of my notes. She's just so clever. The writing's really good. Also, if you're like a writer and want to learn how to craft is a great book for analyzing for craft.
I'm going to read it again just for that and like pick it apart.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And
everything
backdraft it.
Yeah, everything from word choice to sentence construction to paragraph construction to chapter construction. It's all beautifully done. And even the swapping between the different timelines, as Tamara said, you never felt uncomfortable or jerked out of one to another or never started a chapter thinking, where are we now? And it was so subtly done too. It wasn't so, you know, you didn't have chapter headings that said present day or anything. Mm-hmm. It was you knew instantly where you were.
Oh, she did it.
So good. Yeah. She also did something else that I don't think I've ever seen something. So I've seen where dialogue, instead of dialogue, you put in a paragraph that's talking about what the conversation was. She did something different, which was sometimes with dialogue, she wouldn't tell you what the conversation was. She'd just tell you what her response was in such a way that you assume what the question before had to have been. She'll like skip the boring parts of dialogue without, she does this a few times. Once on the phone with Miriam, she just gets to the heart of the conversation without being like,
oh, no.
She doesn't have to do group scenes.
Hmm.
Yeah. I'd never seen anyone do that. Like, they just throw you in the middle of a conversation and you felt like you read it all, and they're like, no, you didn't.
No.
Did either of you look at her back catalog of books? Like, how many times has she done this?
So she's written White Teeth.
Yeah.
I feel like White Teeth, there's two that are her famous ones. I want to look it up because I'm blanking on the other big one she's known for. White Teeth and On Beauty. That's the other one I was thinking about. On Beauty.
We're going to have to look her up. Yeah, we discussed a short story of hers on the Literary Roadhouse a few weeks ago.
I think we've done two of her short stories. We did the one with the real estate woman and the British Nigerian student, and then we also did the Michael Jackson one. Remember?
It's Michael Jackson.
The 9/11 one where Michael Jackson, Elizabeth Taylor, and Marlon Brando are in a car and they're leaving New York after 9/11.
Maybe I might have missed that one. I don't remember that at all.
Let's see. What was it called?
That's a short story?
Hmm.
Yeah.
Wasn't that also a movie?
Escape from New York. Yeah. They might have, I don't know if they made it into a short.
I feel like that happened. There was a controversy, sorry to get sidetracked, but there was a controversy with the guy who was playing Michael Jackson.
Oh, I think that's something else. I remember now. Yeah, that's something else. This whole thing about Michael Jackson, Elizabeth Taylor, Marlon Brando drove on 9/11 and were seen at like a Denny's or an IHOP in like the Midwest because they couldn't get a plane to LA, but they had to get LA, so they rented a car. This is an urban legend apparently from 9/11, and then Zadie decided to write a short story about it.
Yeah. Interesting.
I wonder, actually, Gerald, I think you didn't read that one because we had a guest. We had, I think, Loveland Bettison for that one. So you must have been doing your caravanning.
Yeah, I guess.
Mm-hmm. So we've done two Zadie Smith ones on the Short Story Podcast. And I think I like the Michael Jackson one better than the other one, but neither one of them gave me this impression of just like, this craft is great. These characters are great. So I feel like her novels are different.
Yeah.
I agree. Anything else to add? Nope. Okay, so should we do our like one sentence like summary thing? Recommendation, review.
Read it for the characters.
Mm-hmm.
And the beautiful writing. I still don't know how to feel. I'm still like, but I'm going to read it again, so that tells you something. I don't often read books again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm not a rereader, so that says something.
Yeah.
I've got nothing. I think beautifully drawn characters, clever writing. It doesn't matter. There's no narrative arc.
Yeah, that's what I think I realized by the end of this. I came into this being like, I don't know about this plot, but I don't care anymore. No. It's just, it. You know what? This isn't the kind of book. You know, this is going to sound, I don't know, maybe a little elitist, but if you're the kind of reader who needs the page turner to get to the end of the book, you might struggle because this isn't a page turner. It doesn't have cliffhangers. You're never like, what's going to come next? Will she make it? Because she's not trying to make it anywhere. But if you just like... enjoy the characterizations, enjoy the writing, and you're like already a really disciplined reader, you'll probably like this.
And I think the individual scenes are so well crafted that that once you start reading the scene, you want to finish the scene and enjoy what she's doing with it.
it's definitely a slow burn.
Yeah.
Slow burn's the right word.
Oh, yes.
Okay. So, ready for outro?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So, next month, we're reading Lincoln in the Bardo by George Saunders. Hell yeah. I'm just excited he wrote about it. Yeah. As you read the book, let us know your thoughts on Twitter with the hashtag LRHBookClub or leave comments on our Facebook page or our website, literaryroadhouse.com. Please leave a review on iTunes because it's the only way this independent podcast can get a bigger broadcast in a world controlled by the Illuminati, reptilians, and the 10 percenters. And lastly, we just want to dance in the podcast cloud and need a little bit of help leaving our humble roots behind and making it. Please consider sponsoring us at patreon.com/literaryroadhouse. Every little bit helps. All right. Great discussion, guys.
Really enjoyed it.
Always a pleasure.
Very good. Bye. See you next month. Bye.